and chapter 24, 2 Chronicles chapter 24. Page 707. Joash was 7 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem for 40 years. His mother's name was Zibiah. She was from Beersheba. Joash did what was right in the eyes of the Lord all the years of Jehoiada the priest. Jehoiada chose 2 wives for him, and he had sons and daughters. Sometime later, Joash decided to restore the temple of the Lord. He called together the priests and Levites and said to them, "Go to the towns of Judah and collect the money due annually from all Israel to repair the temple of your God. Do it now." But the Levites did not act at once. Therefore the king summoned Jehoiada, the chief priest, and said to him, "Why haven't you required the Levites to bring in from Judah and Jerusalem the tax imposed by Moses, the servant of the Lord, and by the assembly of Israel for the tent of testimony?" Now the sons of that wicked woman, Athaliah, had broken into the temple of God, and had used even its sacred objects for Baals. At the king's command, a chest was made and placed outside at the gate of the temple of the Lord. A proclamation was then issued in Judah and Jerusalem that they should bring to the Lord the tax that Moses, the servant of God, had required of Israel in the desert. All the officials and all the people brought their contributions gladly, dropping them into the chest until it was full. Whenever the chest was brought in by the Levites to the king's officials, and they saw that there was a large amount of money, the royal secretary and the officer of the chief priest would come and empty the chest and carry it back to its place. They did this regularly and collected a great amount of money. The king and Jehoiada gave it to the men who carried out the work required for the temple of the Lord. They hired masons and carpenters to restore the Lord's temple, and also workers in iron and bronze to repair the temple. The men in charge of the temple were diligent, and the repairs progressed under them. They rebuilt the temple of God according to its original design and reinforced it. When they had finished, they brought the rest of the money to the king and Jehoiada, and with it were made articles for the Lord's temple, articles for the service, and articles and for the burnt offerings, and also dishes and other objects of gold and silver. As long as Jehoiada lived, burnt offerings were presented continually in the temple of the Lord. Now Jehoiada was old and full of years, and he died at the age of 130. He was buried with the kings in the city of David because of the good he had done in Israel for God and his people, and his temple. After the death of Jehoiada, the officials of Judah came and paid homage to the king, and he listened to them. They abandoned the temple, the God of their fathers, and worship Asherah gods and idols. Because of their guilt, God's anger came upon Judah and Jerusalem. Although the Lord sent prophets to the people to bring them back to him, and though they testified against them, they would not listen. Then the Spirit of God came upon Zechariah, son of Jehoiada the priest, He stood before the people and said, "This is what God says. Why do you disobey the Lord's commands? You will not prosper. Because you have forsaken the Lord, he has forsaken you." But they plotted against him, and by order of the king they stoned him to death in the courtyard of the king of the Lord's temple. King Joash did not remember the kindness Zechariah's father Jehoiada had shown him, but killed his son, who said as he lay dying, "May the Lord see this and call you to account." At the turn of the year, the army of Aram marched against Joash. He invaded Judah and Jerusalem and killed all the leaders of the people. They sent all the plunders of their king in Damascus. Although the Aramean army had come with only a few men, the Lord delivered into their hands a much larger army. Because Judah had forsaken the Lord, the God of their fathers, judgment was executed on Joash. When the Arameans withdrew, they left Joash severely wounded. His officials conspired against him for murdering the son of Jehoiada the priest, and they killed him in his bed. So he died and was buried in the city of David, but not in the tombs of the kings. Those who conspired against him were Zabad, son of Shimeath, an Ammonite woman, and Jehoshabad, son of Shimri, a Moabite woman. The account of his sons, the many prophecies about him, and the record of the restoration of the temple of God are written in the annotations on the book of the kings. And Amaziah, his son, succeeded as king. Shall we pray? Lord God, we thank you for this opportunity tonight to consider your word, and we thank you for all the different stories and accounts that there are in the Bible are written for our benefit and for our instruction. Lord, please help me to teach your people tonight in a helpful way and in the power of your Spirit. And please also, Lord, help us all to hear your word and to heed it because of practice. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, this story that I read to us gives us the account of a man who had two halves of the story of his life. The first half of his life, he looked like he was a true believer. He looked like he was somebody who was very keen to serve God. And he seemed to do a lot of good. But the second half of his life, he became really a complete unbeliever. He led the people of Israel into idol worship. The very temple which he had helped to restore fell into ruin again. And he landed up persecuting a prophet who came to warn him of what he was doing. This prophet was actually the son of the official priest who had rescued him from an evil woman who had usurped the kingdom. Now, so what we have here is an example of what sometimes people call apostasy. What is apostasy? Apostasy is where somebody knows a lot about God, and somebody makes a profession of being a believer in God, and they look like they're serving God, and then at certain point in that person's life, he or she turns away and goes right against that faith which they once professed. Now, the turning point in this man's life, it seems, was the death of the high priest, Jehoiada, who had been instrumental in his rescue from death, and who in his early years was a very good influence upon him. And it seems that when this man died, Joash then turned away from that faith which he had once professed. And it would seem that he was perhaps a pliable character, somebody who had no real, genuine faith of his own. Somebody who easily came under the influence of other people. So when he was under a good influence, he thought it was good, right? But then when later on he came under a bad influence, then started to do what was wrong. Didn't have any real genuine faith in his own. That would seem to be what's going on. Now, I'd like to say to you that this story is actually a very, very important story for us to look at, and it's got some important lessons for us all. Because surely all of us know people who maybe, for instance, as young people were brought up in Christian homes, made fresh in faith, got baptized, maybe were involved in evangelism, looked like they were really keenly serving the Lord, but then came a certain point in their lives and the influence that they were under, maybe from their parents or from their siblings, wore off. They came under other influence from their friends around them at university or at school or whatever, and then they went right away, gone right away from genuine faith and service to the Lord. Some of us also perhaps can think of those who maybe a man who's married to a Christian woman, and it seemed like the man was converted, looked like he was a Christian, but then after a while became very, very questionable whether he really is a Christian at all. Some of us perhaps can think of pastors who have preached gospel sermons, who have been instrumental in the conversion of others, have built up big churches, and then have gone away from biblical Christianity and have renounced the faith that they once were instrumental in building up. And today are now opposing that very same faith. So what we've got here is an example, a biblical example, of that word apostasy, of where people, a person turns away from genuine biblical faith. Now, let me give you the context, the background. It's a long time since we've been in 2 Chronicles, so it might be good for me just to remind you. Basically, the rot set in, if you remember, when Jehoshaphat, who had been a good man, he entered into an alliance, a marriage alliance, with the king of Israel, who was Ahab, who was a thoroughly wicked man. And so his son, Jehoshaphat's son, go back to chapter 21, Jehoshaphat's son was a man called Jehoram. And he was married to a very wicked woman who was a daughter of Ahab called Athaliah. And Jehoram did what? Disobeyed God, and God sent him a prophet, sent him a letter from Elijah, the prophet, saying that he was going to die a very horrible death, his bowels were going to come out, and that's what happened. And then his son Ahaziah became king, and he also walked in the ways of Ahab, and he ended up getting killed by Jehu, who God has sent to destroy all the family of Ahab. Now, when Ahaziah died, his mother, Athaliah, then proceeded to kill all of Ahaziah's children and all the other members of the family, all the other members of the royal family of Judah. And she put herself in power. And for a few years, she reigned as a usurping queen mother. But one of the children of Ahaziah, Joash, who was a little tiny baby at the time that Athaliah went around killing all the royal family, he was hidden by his aunt, the sister of the king, Jehosheba. And Jehosheba was married to Jehoiada, the high priest. So what happened was, he was this little boy, this baby boy, was hidden in the temple by Jehoiada, the high priest, and kept safe for 7 years of his life. And then in the seventh year, Jehoiada then basically staged a coup, what we call a coup. It was a good or revolution, if you like. He brought out Jehoiada and he proclaimed him to be king, and Athaliah, this wicked woman who had usurped the power, was then put to death. And Jehoiada showed himself by this to be a godly man, a man who was zealous for God. And it was his timely action in protecting this little baby that enabled God's purposes of a Messiah to come through the line of David to be fulfilled. Because if all of the descendants of David had all been wiped out, then this promise of God would not have been fulfilled. God used this man, Jehoiada, to save Joash and to save the royal line of David. Okay, so that's the background. Now, let's then look at Joash's life. And we have, first of all, a summary given in verses 1 and 2 of chapter 23. Joash was 7 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 40 years. His mother's name was Zibiah. She was from Beersheba. Joash did what was right in the eyes of the Lord all the years of Jehoiada the priest. Jehoiada chose two wives for him, and he had two sons, and he had sons and daughters. So here is this godly man, Jehoiada. And all the time that this godly man was around, it's obviously a very strong character, a very powerful influence for good. And all the time that Jehoiada was around and alive, Joash lived in a good and right way. And he had every appearance of being somebody wanted to serve God. But when Jehoiada died, then things went very badly wrong. Okay, so that's the summary of his life. Then let's then look at the first half of his reign. And this is verses 4 through to 16. I'm not going to read those verses again. We read them earlier. But notice from these verses that Joash appeared to be somebody who really wanted to serve God. It says in verse 4 that he decided to restore the temple of the Lord. So it seems as though this was his decision. And he called together the priests and the Levites, and he told them to go out, and he told them to collect from all of Israel the annual money which should have been collected to repair the temple. And when this did not happen, as it should have done, as we see from the end of verse 5, he then called in Jehoiada, the chief priest, and he said to him, why has this not happened? And then he commanded that a chest should be placed outside the temple, and a proclamation should be issued to all of Judah and Jerusalem that they should bring to the Lord the tax that Moses had said should be given. And it says in verse 10 that all the officials and all the peoples brought their contributions gladly, dropping them into the chest, and that when the chest was full, then the money was emptied out, and they used the money to pay the workmen to repair the temple of the Lord. Remember that the temple of the Lord had, it would seem, by this time fallen into disrepair because of the worship of idols that had gone on under Joash's father and under his grandfather. Temple of the Lord had fallen into disrepair, but now it seems he's very keen that the worship of God should be restored, the temple should be repaired, and he makes sure that it happens. So this money is used to pay workmen who repair the temple. And it says, verse 13, the men in charge of the work were diligent, repairs progressed unto them, they rebuilt the temple of the Lord according to its original design. And then they then had money left over, and they used that money to remake the articles for the temple, articles for the service, and for burnt offerings and dishes and other objects of gold and silver and so on. Because what had happened, if you go back to verse 7, is that the original sacred objects had been stolen from the temple by Athaliah and used for the worship of Baal. So the result of this was that worship of the Lord was restored, and we read that towards the end of verse 14, as long as Jehoiada lived, burnt offerings were presented continually in the temple of the Lord. So where the worship of God had come to a halt under, first of all, Joash's grandfather, then under his father, and then under Athaliah, under the good influence of Jehoiada, Joash made sure that the worship of the Lord was that the temple was rebuilt or was repaired, and the worship of God was restored, and regular offerings of worship of God went on. So here's this first part of his life. And if he'd have died at this point, we probably would have said, oh, well, this was a great man. This was a true, we would have thought of him as a true believer, a good man, who had served God kingly, who restored the worship of God, and we would have thought, good man, great, good story. But, well, Read verse 15. Now Jehoiada was old and full of years. He died at the age of 130. He was buried with the kings in the city of David because of the good he'd done in Israel for God and his temple. So this high priesthood who had done so much good for the monarchy, he'd rescued Joash from being killed, protected him, and he'd established him as king. He'd been so instrumental in the temple being restored, the worship of God being restored. This good man, who had been such a good influence on Joash, died. And out of recognition for all he'd done, he was buried in a special place where the kings were buried in the city of David. Now, then after this, after his death, things went very badly wrong in Joash's life. And it seems that the beginning of it was bad influence from the other officials. Verse 17. After the death of Jehoiada, the officials of Judah came and paid homage to the king, and he listened to them. See, before he was listening to Jehoiada, he was coming under, he was submitting himself to Jehoiada's influence and leadership. But now Jehoiada has died. These other people were being listened to instead. Now here's a warning for us. The Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 34, come to your senses as you ought and stop sinning. Sorry, verse 33. Do not be misled. Bad company corrupts good character. If you get into bad company at your school, or at your college, or in your workplace, you are likely find your character suffering. And you may well find yourself wandering far from Christian practice, even Christian faith. So that was, it seems, the root or the beginning of Jehoiada's problem. He started to listen to advice from people whose advice was not worth listening to. Remember Psalm 1. Psalm says, blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of mockers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, whose leaf does not wither. Whatever he does prospers. Not so the wicked, they are like the chaff, the wind blows away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. Joash showed himself to be somebody whose heart was essentially wicked because he did not listen. He did not continue to listen to good advice. He listened to counsel of the wicked. And I would suggest to you that what's going on here is that he is a man who had no real conviction. prophets of Jehoiada, he went along with Jehoiada's agenda. But he didn't really do this because it's what he believed was right. It wasn't because he had real faith. But just because he was somebody who followed what other people said. And so when there was this strong influence from Jehoiada, and that was an influence for good, then he did what was right. But once that influence was removed from his life, the corruption that was really there already in his heart, and the lack of faith and the lack of real conviction that there was inside him, revealed itself. And he became very susceptible to bad influence and bad company. So here is something I say to young people here, and to us older ones as well. Do you really have faith in yourself? Do you really believe in the Lord Jesus Christ yourself? At the moment, you're under the influence of self-extremes of your parents, under their influence and their encouragement. Maybe they make you come to church, I don't know. But there is that influence there that encourages you to keep coming to church and to keep coming to, and doing what is right. But as you grow older, that influence is going to wane. Is there that faith that is within you, that genuine, real faith that is within you, that will stand when the influence from your parents wanes? What's going to happen to your faith when your parents die? At some point they'll die. Will you have real faith then? What's going to happen when you go to university? What's going to happen when you get your own job and you get your own place to live? I just ask each one of you to challenge your own hearts. Do I have real faith? Am I really a true Christian? Or am I, as it were, piggybacking on the back of the faith of my parents? That's what Joash was really doing here. He was piggybacking on the back of Jehoiada's faith. I suggest he didn't have any real faith of his own. And that was his problem. Now what about you? And what about some of our older ones here as well? Maybe because of influence from your spouse, or maybe because of influence from elderly parents, you're still maintaining an outward semblance of Christian profession, faith, and Christian obedience. But what's going to happen to you when that influence is gone? Isn't that real faith in you? So Joash fell very easily under the influence of godless people. And we see what happened. First of all, they abandoned true worship, verse 18. They abandoned the temple of the Lord, the God of their fathers, and worshipped Asherah poles and idols. Now this is amazing, isn't it? Here's a man who spent many, many years restoring the temple. And he's put in a huge amount of effort getting people to getting the money together and organizing the workers should rebuild the temple and things. And then suddenly, it's as if he'd never done it. He now abandons the temple of the Lord. And now they start worshipping Asherah poles and idols. Now then, it says that God's, because of their guilt, God's anger came upon Judah and Jerusalem. Well, surely if he was a true believer, he would have said to himself, as God disciplined him, I need to stop this. But he hardened his heart and didn't listen. Verse 19, although the Lord sent prophets and people to bring them back to him, though they testified against them, they would not listen. Joash wouldn't listen, and the people around him wouldn't listen. The people in Jerusalem would not listen. Well then, something very extraordinary happened. God caused Zechariah, the son of Jehoiada, this man who'd been this great influence upon Joash, to to come and prophesy. And we read these words of prophecy in verse 20. This is what God says. Why do you disobey the Lord's commands? You will not prosper. Because you have forsaken the Lord, he has forsaken you. So here is now a very strong direct warning given by Zechariah, the son of Joash, that they have disobeyed God, that they're not going to prosper if they continue down this path, and that because they've forsaken God, God has forsaken them. By the way, this does shed an interesting light, doesn't it, on the promise that people love to put up on their walls, you know, never will I forsake you, never will I leave you. Well, there is that promise there that God made to Joshua. But God was telling Joshua that he had to go, and he had to obey him, and he had to go and fight the battles that he had to fight. And as he went and did so, God would not forsake him. But here's a clear warning that if we deliberately forsake God, he will forsake us. If we abandon the faith that we had once professed, maybe because we were never Christians in the first place, we will know what it is to be forsaken by God. Now, when this solemn message came, how did Joash respond? Well, tragically, he ended up persecuting this man. And verse 21, they plotted against him by order of the king, and they stoned him to death in the courtyard of the Lord's temple. This was the son of the man who had rescued Joash from death. And Joash forgets the kindness that Jehoiada had shown him and kills his own son, kills the son of Jehoiada. How extraordinary that a man who seemed to be so zealous of God, so keen that the temple of the Lord should be rebuilt, he finds himself actually putting the son of the person who rescued him to death. And as the writer comments, verse 22, King Joash did not remember the kindness of Zechariah's father, Jehoiada, had shown him, but killed his son. He said, as he laid him, may the Lord see this and call you to account. Well, then, prophecy that Zechariah had made was fulfilled. And we read, verse 23, that at the turn of the year, the army of Aaron marched against Joash, invaded Judah and Jerusalem, and killed all the leaders of the people. They sent all the plunder of their king to their king of Damascus. And in verse 24 it says, although the Aramean army had come with only a few men, the Lord delivered into their hands a much larger army. So Judah had a huge army to defend itself, but because Joash had forsaken the Lord was not with him. And they were defenseless against this much smaller army from Aram, which had come up against them. As it says there, because Judah had forsaken the Lord, the God of their fathers, judgment was executed on Joash. So then the army withdrew, and leaving Joash severely wounded, and then his officials conspired against him, and they murdered him as he lay on his bed. So here's a very solemn passage for us. A man who had made a very clear and strong profession of faith in God, who had appeared to love God and appeared to want to serve God, actually turned out, you would seem, not to be a true believer at all. And actually became a persecutor of servants of God. Well then, how can we apply this to ourselves? Well, first of all, surely every single one of us, we need to test ourselves to see whether we really are Christians. Paul says in 2 Corinthians, he says, test yourselves to see whether you are of the faith. It really is very, very important. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5. Examine yourselves to see whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. That's what we must do. And the passage of this shows us how important it is to test ourselves. You might say, well, I come to church every Sunday. Maybe you do. You might say, well, I've been baptized. Well, maybe I have. Maybe you have. You might say, well, I'm involved in evangelism. Well, maybe you are. You might say, well, I've seen people converted through my work. Maybe you have. You come to prayer meeting. Well, maybe you do. You've seen answers to prayer. Well, maybe you have. Joash could have said all of those things. But it turned out, it seems, was not a true believer to him. So we really, all of us, still need to examine ourselves and to see whether we really are Christians. And to ask ourselves, why do I do what I do? Do I do what I do because I'm worried that somebody's going to disapprove of me? Because I'm worried that, say, maybe a pastor will come and visit me, or maybe because I'm worried that people might not think I'm the sort of person I should be. Why do you actually do what you do? The reason should be that you know that you're a sinner. You know that you deserve hell. You know that Christ has died for your sins. And you want to serve the Lord because of what He has done for you. Because you know He saved you from going to hell. It should be out of fear of the Lord that we do what we do. If we do it for any other reason, we are very, very dangerous. So we need to test ourselves. Am I really a Christian? And don't just take it for granted because of certain things. On the outside. What should you do if you're in any doubt? Well, probably you'll be able to tell somebody else. Just do what you would say to somebody else. You need to repent. Repent of your sins. Come to Jesus and sin. Look to Him to be your Savior. Don't leave it to chance. Make sure you really are a true Christian. Shall we just have a few moments of practice to...